I've been covering the political crisis and the recent protests in the streets of Malaysia this week, and I'm trying to point out to people that the US is engaged in a region-wide effort to destabilize the entire region. Their goal is to encircle and contain China. They're going to do this by removing all of the governments in the region from power who are building constructive ties with China and replacing them with client regimes that will try to roll those ties backwards. And if that fails, they will be more than happy to just divide and destroy these countries and leave China with no constructive or prosperous partners to deal with. The US does not have an alternative to the economic ties, the infrastructure projects, the investments, the amount of tourism coming out of China. They have no answer to that. So they have turned to subversion and they have turned to regime change operations. So when I told people that these protests in Malaysia were backed by the US, most people seem to agree. I have had a lot of people from Malaysia point out a lot of other things, very alarming things about the US role in interfering in Malaysia's internal political affairs. But there's a large number of people who just don't seem to get it. They said, everyone is unhappy. The government is failing us. The economic and health crisis right now is too much to bear, and we need a new government. And they don't seem to understand that while all of that might be true, the answer is not going out into the streets, joining US-backed opposition groups, and overthrowing your government. These protests are cynically taking advantage of the crisis. They have no solution once they get into power to make things any better. And the chaos they're going to create in the meantime, while trying to take power, is only going to make everything worse for everybody. But that's not what this video is about. I want to get into Bercy. I've had people tell me Bercy is not funded by the US government. It most certainly is, and I have the head of Bercy admit it, and I have the National Endowment for Democracy and its subsidiaries admitting it. So let's get right into that. Malaysian Insider report from July 27th, 2011, and they said that the leader of Bercy, this woman named Ambika, admitted to Bercy receiving some money from two US organizations, the National Democratic Institute and Open Society Institute, for other projects which she stressed were unrelated to the July 9th, 2011 march. So that's the head of Bercy admitting that they received money from the US government through the National Endowment for Democracy because the National Democratic Institute, as well as the International Republican Institute, these are subsidiaries of the NED. And she also admits that she took money from George Soros's Open Society. And here is the US government's own National Democratic Institute admitting it. So this was from 2011, their profile for Malaysia. If you come down to current activities, there's this very interesting paragraph. In July 2005, NDI organized a national-level workshop for party leaders on election reform. NDI has since conducted many workshops across Malaysia to promote electoral reform in collaboration with Research for Social Advancement, the Secretariat for Bercy. In 2006, NDI conducted a workshop for Bercy that focused on improving the action plans of each participating organization or political party and accomplishing their objectives. In 2007, NDI and Bercy conducted a series of workshops in the politically neglected provinces of Sabah and Sarawak to educate previously disenfranchised political aspirants. This is the US government openly admitting to the fact that they are involved in every aspect of Malaysia's internal political affairs and even their electoral system. Again, this is exactly what the US accused Russia of doing without any evidence at all, while they openly admit that they're doing it to other nations like Malaysia. And who is helping them do it? Bercy and people like Ambika and people like Anwar Ibrahim and the people at Malaysia Kini who are fully funded by the US government, Open Society, and then they trick their readers into subscribing to their news so they could get even more money. And one more thing about Ambika and her Bercy movement, it's more than just that NDI US government funding, which is bad enough. But if you go to Bercy's official website and you go to their webpage endorsing NGOs and you look through this list, many of these are funded by the US government or by George Soros's Open Society or by other foreign governments or corporate foundations. For example, take note of Lawyers for Liberty and Pusat Kamus. And then if you go to the National Endowment for Democracy's official website and you go to their page for Malaysia 2020 and you scroll down, there's Pusat Kamas and there's Lawyers for Liberty. They get 2 grants and they're very active in pushing all of this street unrest and constant call for regime change. So this is more than just a casual association. Per se represents a coalition of foreign interference inside of Malaysia. And down here, just in case you didn't believe me, NDI programming for Malaysia is funded by the National Endowment for Democracy. Now that's the NDI. There is also the IRI, again, the International Republican Institute. Here is Daniel Twining of IRI openly admitting that from 2002 onward, the US government, through his organization and with NED money, they have built up the opposition in Malaysia and helped install them into power in 2018. And why? To block Chinese investments and to cancel Chinese infrastructure projects. Let's listen to Daniel again.
Malaysia, for 61 years, one party governed this country since it became independent in 1957. So, IRI, we had worked in Malaysia with opposition political parties since 2002. And guess whose funding we did it with? The National Endowment for Democracy. So for 15 years, working with NED resources, we worked to strengthen Malaysian opposition parties. And guess what happened 2 months ago? After 61 years, they won. I visited and I was sitting there with many of the leaders, the new leaders of this government, many of whom were just our partners we had been working with for 15 years, and one of the most senior of them, who's now one of the people running the government, said to me, gosh, IRI, you never gave up on us even when we were ready to give up on ourselves, right? And we're sitting in the Prime Minister's office. Here we are. Guess what the first step, really one of the first steps the new government took? It froze Chinese infrastructure investments. This is not a hugely pro-American country. It's probably never going to be an actual US ally. But this is going to redound to our benefit, right? And that's an example of the long game.
So there you have it. And I've pointed out in previous videos that the National Endowment for Democracy, even though they say up here supporting freedom around the world, you've got people like Damon Wilson from the Atlantic Council, a pro-war corporate-funded think tank that gets its money from arms manufacturers, oil companies, and banks. There's people like Elliot Abrams, who's a war criminal. He is a literal criminal that required a presidential pardon. He was overseeing death squads in Latin America as part of US regime change efforts there. And he has been directly involved in trying to overthrow the governments of Iraq, Iran, Venezuela. And he's a very vocal proponent of Israeli aggression all over the Middle East. You also have people like Scott Carpenter, who literally participated in the illegal US invasion and occupation of Iraq. He was part of the provisional government there. He was this white American man literally running the country, which is what the NED is actually all about. It's about setting up the modern day equivalent of the British Empire's administrative system, where they would rule over a country like Malaysia. They would get locals into the administrative system to help run it, but ultimately everything that administrative system did was to serve the British Empire. This is what the NED is setting up in countries like Malaysia, Myanmar, here in Thailand, everywhere the NED is active, this is what they're doing. It's modern day imperialism. And I talked about the regional effort the US is involved in to create chaos in all of these countries, not just Malaysia, but also Thailand, Myanmar. They were doing it in Hong Kong. The protesters themselves will invoke the term Asia Spring in reference to the Arab Spring. So I just want to remind people of this New York Times article from 2011. US groups helped nurture Arab uprising. And if you come down here, they mention by name a number of the groups and individuals directly involved in the revolts and reforms sweeping the region received training and financing from groups like the International Republican Institute, the National Democratic Institute, and Freedom House. And then they talk about how they are subsidiaries of the National Endowment for Democracy. It's worth repeating over and over again, because no matter how irrefutable the evidence is, I'm still seeing an alarming, it's a minority, but it's an alarmingly large minority of people who still get into the comment section and say, this is not real, this isn't true. If you don't believe any of this information, go to the video description. I put the links to all of these. You can look with your own eyes. You can go to Malaysia Kini's own website and see where they list the National Endowment for Democracy as one of their funding sources, or George Soros' Open Society as one of their funding sources. Regarding Anwar Ibrahim here, who liked to participate at the Bursay protests out in the streets, people have tried to deny that Anwar Ibrahim is a U.S. puppet. And that's after watching a video where I show a photo of him literally in Washington, D.C. with the president of the NED participating in an NED event. This is from the 2007 NED annual report, their Democracy Award. If you go down to page 3, zoom in to this picture. That's Anwar Ibrahim right there to the left. And there's his name right there, Anwar Ibrahim. This is him in Washington, D.C. That's the president of the NED. You could see everyone from the NED, the NDI. This is another NED subsidiary, CIPE. They're all there. He's hanging out with all of them. And if you're like, well, that's 2007, that's a long time ago. Maybe he's changed. This is from 2019. Right here, that's him talking. The Embassy of Canada and the National Endowment for Democracy present the 5th Annual Seymour Martin Lipset Lecture on Democracy in the World, featuring Anwar Ibrahim, President, People's Justice Party of Malaysia, on confronting authoritarianism. Where? The Embassy of Canada, Washington, D.C. So that was 2019. The U.S. interferes in countries all around the world. These are the people, the media platforms, and the organizations that are enabling the U.S. to interfere in Malaysia's internal political affairs. And one last thing to mention, the U.S. might pretend like they're trying to help support democracy. I want to point out again that democracy is a process of self-determination. If a foreign country is involved in your democratic process, they're not helping it. They are undermining it. That is called foreign interference. It is a violation of the UN Charter. It is undermining a nation's sovereignty. That country and the people in it, and only them, are allowed to determine their fate and their future. The US trying to influence that is a violation of the UN Charter. So I'm sure in the comments section of this video, I'm still going to have people say that it's fake. If you were on the fence, or you are genuinely open-minded and an honest person, please go to the video description and look at the links and look at it for yourself. I'm not making this up. These aren't photoshopped. Check it out for yourself. Nobody said that you have to be happy with your current government, but make sure when you're in the frying pan, you don't jump out into the fire. This is what happened in 2011 during the Arab Spring. People were legitimately upset with their governments. The US had opposition groups out into the streets, draw these people out, and helped trigger a chain of events that have destroyed entire countries ever since, ruined the lives of millions of people from North Africa to Central Asia and everywhere in between. Asia needs to be careful. They need to avoid doing this. The Arab Spring, it could be argued that maybe people didn't see it coming. When you have protesters out in the street backed by the US government shouting, "Asia Spring," they're telling you that they're going to do it again. Are we going to wake up and stop them in time? If you thought this video was useful, please like and share it. Think about subscribing. It's free to do and it helps the channel grow. Again, please check the video description for all of the links that I just talked about. There's also ways in the video description where you can help support my work, either through a one-time donation or by becoming a Patreon member. Through Patreon, you can help support my work month to month. I give some of my Patreon members a sneak peek at upcoming videos. There's channels of communication where we can share ideas and kind of build a community around this work. For people who are helping, even if you're just sharing my articles, or putting a kind comment in the comment section, thank you very much. All of that help is appreciated. And to everyone, as always, thank you for watching.